€1,800 a month for each. Do the math. I frown. Spring could come before I successfully multiply 18 by 8. With raised eyebrows, I attempted to convey this helplessness. Who pays that much, I asked. Your people, my friend said. Americans. I laughed with a hand over my mouth and we stood for a moment staring at the building. Then he said, go in. I'll wait here. What, I asked? Just go in. Tell me what it's like. I shook my head. Why don't you go? Have you not been listening at all? I shouldn't even be here. They were going to kill me. He was my friend, and these things mattered to me, so I crossed the street and stepped calmly into the building's poorly lit vestibule. The door had been propped open with a metal ashtray. The marble floor was cracked and dusty. Someone was moving in or moving out, either repairing the lobby or slowly digging it apart with artisanal folkloric tools it was impossible to tell. There was graffiti in 5 languages on the elevator door. If the Spanish were to be believed, it all referred to the unreliability of the machine. Still, an elevator. In Barcelona, this was a luxury. I could see why my friend had been interested. An orange tarp in the corner covered a pile of bricks, and a boy of perhaps 14 sat atop it, face lit by the glow of his cell phone screen. He looked me over. It was clear he didn't trust me. Behind him, to the right of the pile of bricks, there was a door opening into a long, tight hallway, and I could hear voices coming from inside. Arabic. I tried to peer in. I'm not sure why. It wasn't that I was curious, necessarily. I just wanted something to share with my friend, some detail to prove that I'd been inside. What do you want, the boy asked in Spanish. Nothing, I said. He sneered, then raised his phone and took a picture. A false digital click made my stomach turn. I posed against my will, a wince adorning my face, my throbbing tooth exposed. Hey, I said, in mute protest, as he took another. My cheeks flushed, and I pressed my lips together tightly. There was no way to ignore the pain in my mouth. Get out of here, the boy said, and I hurried into the street. Outside, my friend was heaving with a smile. I was shaken, but he didn't notice at all. So what'd you think, he asked. My heart was racing. It's a shithole, I managed to say. A real dump. I know, he responded, laughing. It was exactly what he wanted to hear. But I couldn't laugh anymore. We walked towards La Rambla much faster now. All my shame had concentrated in my tooth. Night was approaching all at once. His was the most common immigrant story of all, my friend said. He'd come to Europe, sorted with success, tasted failure. He found it all funny now. Such was his relief, and he bore no grudge against the Ecuadorian or the Moroccan or anyone. The calls no longer came, not in the middle of the night or ever. His daughter would not be raised an orphan, and if he had to work 3 jobs, and if he had to work 3 jobs for the next 20 years, he would pay back all the money he owed, every cent, and do it with a smile. Show me one. A smile of genuine happiness, deep, whiter than pearls, a smile I couldn't help but envy. I tried to mirror it, but just then a cold wind blew. He called everyone in Lima, the people he trusted, but he hadn't called me. I realized this and felt despair floating like a cloud before me. Why did no one believe in me? Instinctively, I covered my mouth, and my friend, who hadn't stopped laughing for an hour, turned serious, concerned. He grabbed my shoulder, and suddenly it was dark. This message is called Eyes. I was in Lima for the first half of that year, for 2 months, winter months in the southern hemisphere, and I visited my cousin's dental office every Tuesday. I'd gotten financing for a recording project, and since I had no insurance back in the States, it seemed like a good idea to get my teeth fixed. Before I left, my girlfriend let me know she approved. Maybe, she said, it will make you more willing to smile. My cousin and I had a standing appointment, which I kept at all costs. My case was a difficult one. He told me again and again, repeating it so often, I began to take some pride in this. How'd you break your front teeth, he asked, on my first visit, and without hesitating, I described a schoolyard fight I'd once observed. 2 brave, wiry boys pummeling one another with abandon. In my telling, I was one of the boys. Interesting, my cousin said, and ordered x-rays as if to confirm my story. When I was a boy, my cousin lived with my family in Birmingham, Alabama. He went to the local public school, and most weeknights, one young lady or another would phone our house and ask to speak to, and here, she would stretch out his name in an impossible southern drawl, and my mother, always severe, would correct her, and called his name out loud. Upon hearing it, my cousin would race to the kitchen like a man on fire, stretching the long cord into the hallway where he'd spend an hour whispering his broken, seductive English into the receiver. In matters of flirting, he was a minimalist. Oh, your hair, he'd say, or oh, your eyes. I'd eavesdrop, unable to fathom what a girl might say in response to these cues. When it was over, he'd lock himself in the bathroom, emerge a while later, showered and combed, and as we prepared for bed, my cousin, flummoxed and anxious, would ask me in Spanish, what do American girls want? I was 8 years old. Now my weekly dental appointments were the only time we saw each other. We didn't talk much. I spent most of our time together with my mouth open, blinded by the overhead lamp, trying to block out the sound and sensation of the drill. I curled my toes in my shoes, or jammed my hands into my pockets and squeezed my wallet like a man being mugged. I'm sensitive to pain, I told him on that first day, hoping he would be gentle. He smiled. I know, he said. I remember from when we were kids. My cousin's regular assistant was young, a novice, charged mainly with suction and spit from my mouth with a transparent plastic tube. To accomplish this task, she hovered close, blinking her gentle, unjudging eyes at me, and though I rarely saw her without a face mask, I'd begun over the course of my long and complicated treatment to imagine she was quite beautiful. My cousin sawed my teeth, chipped them, filed them, burnished them, polished them, bleached them, carved them, and all through this tortuous process, his assistant wiped spittle from my cheeks with an affectionate gesture and visible smile I'd come to crave. In the course of these endless appointments, I'd established certain routines, ones that involved sublimating the discomfort of the drill with thoughts of sex. I undressed my cousin's dental assistant with my eyes. My girlfriend had stayed back in the States, and though things were not well with us for the moment, I was attempting fidelity and managing this famine only by giving myself certain creative license. How else to survive? There was nothing to look at but the assistant or the unadorned wall, and naturally, I preferred to imagine what juicy lips were hidden behind her protective face mask. I tore off her white uniform, why not, I could see through it anyway, and bent her over the counter and tongued her ear until it sparkled. My cousin was planning to marry a woman named Carmen, who was finishing her last year of law school. She was lovely, short and curvaceous, and wore her dark bangs pressed diagonally against her forehead with a rigid plasticine gel. Unlike American girls, she was quite clear about what she wanted. For starters, a church wedding, a white dress, a slow waltz before the entire family and camera flashes popping from every direction, a bottle of whiskey on each table, and a tawdry night at the Sheraton in Minneapolis overlooking the sea. Later, a parcel of children who studied at the American school in a house with room enough for a maid and a garden to receive guests. These were things anyone could tell just by looking at her.